Hey everybody, this is Brett. Welcome back to School Sucks Podcast. Today is September 20th, and this is, for now anyway, the conclusion to our series, Presence and Productivity. There might be, coming in the future, some addenda, that is, multiple addendums, additions, to what we've done here so far. But I thought this was a nice way to end for now. Our friend Jake Desyllas from the Voluntary Life podcast contacted me last week and he said, Brett, I think it's great that you're doing this series. I've used GTD for many years. And if you're unfamiliar with Jake, first of all, I suggest you check out his podcast, The Voluntary Life. You can also search his name in the School Sucks archives. He gave a speech with me at Porkfest in 2012, and we did this talk about schooling versus the entrepreneurial spirit. Jake is a very successful entrepreneur, but the observation that I had in the time I've spent with him and talking to him is that he's also very relaxed, and I want to know what's the secret, you know? So I wasn't surprised when he contacted me last week and said he had been using GTD for 6 or 7 years. He also says that he felt really overwhelmed the first 5 years that he ran his business. I think he said he discovered GTD around 2006. And what we're going to do on the show today is discuss some tools that Jake has suggested on his podcast in the past. We're going to go through 8 tools that are either already integrated with or integratable with the GTD method. You know, we'll talk about each one and we'll leave you with some, I think, concrete ideas and suggestions for how you can go forward here. Of course, I do want to reiterate that I recommend going through the GTD materials for yourself. Jake is going to mention something in the show. If you don't want to buy the book and you don't want to spend even 1 cent on this, well, I have good news. Jake told me about something that I have since checked out called the GTD Virtual Study Group. It's a podcast. You can find it on iTunes. If they're still doing it, you could probably figure out how to call in and participate if you have questions. But I would say start at the beginning. They go through, the basics of GTD, other kinds of tools or apps or pieces of software that can be integrated into GTD. There's a lot there. So if you've already gotten started and you're already feeling somewhat comfortable with this, you know, you can skim through their archives and, see what knowledge deficits you might have and download accordingly. So that's it. This was a really fantastic conversation. As soon as we were done recording, I said, wow, that was terrific, Jake. Thank you so much. I definitely want to work with Jake more in the future. And like I said, Voluntary Life, please check out his podcast. He made a very, very valuable contribution to our series here. So we're going to start our conversation here, already in progress. This is Jake Desyllas and 8 tools for a freed mind and a voluntary life. All right, here we go.
Do you remember a show that was on MTV called Making the Band with P. Diddy?
No.
Well, anyway, P. Diddy has this guy who follows him around named Fonzworth Bentley. And he's very, you know, well-dressed, sophisticated man. He's carrying an umbrella with P. Diddy in the rain, and he's got a notebook, and he's got suspenders. And he's P. Diddy's personal concierge, and he became this intriguing figure. Like, P. Diddy has this guy who just follows him around. And I said, I need someone like that. Now, that's impossible for me, given my situation, but it came back to mind as I was trying to describe the benefits of GTD to my brother. And it also kind of points out the divide between ordinary people and the super rich, you know, where they are able to all of these responsibilities that we have to, you know, keep in our minds and deal with in everyday life, from, you know, laundry to work related things, all of those tasks can be externalized to some kind of assistant. And then these people have this lifestyle where they have all this freed mental RAM to devote to the things that are important to them. Unfortunately, it's things like, you know, as far as these Hollywood types are concerned, you know, auditing their thetan levels and getting Obama reelected. But, you know, think about what people like us can do with that free time. And that's what GTD seems to provide.
Yeah, that's a nice way of looking at it. It's like having a butler only without having to pay for one.
Yeah, exactly. Exactly.
Yeah.
And, you know, the other thing is that we have all of these natural skills Yeah, I mean, we're observant creatures. We observe. We want to, with our observations, make identifications. And with those identifications, we want to make sense out of them and make them useful. So this is the natural inclination of a human being to do these things. But if we don't do them, you know, identify them and integrate them as part of a larger purpose-based system, they might just seem like impulses. In other words, they're not tools that we can consistently know to call upon and make use of. And the goal of those tools is to have that freed mind. So I think when we have all these things going on without a system or without a Fonsworth P. Bentley personal concierge, we're being held hostage. And, you know, a hostage situation is pretty much the antithesis of freedom.
And the way I think about it, too, is that I find it to be a way of sort of increasing the power of my mind without taking any weird drugs or something. You know, it's like the way of plugging your brain in to something that you can increase your capabilities with without and doing that in a really productive way. Because the whole idea behind getting things done and getting things out of your head and into systems where you write things down or maybe use an app or whatever, all that's doing is just extending the capabilities of your mind. It's giving your mind tools so that you're actually able to increase the reach of your thinking and able to actually have far more effective thinking and be far more effective in your life because you're using tools to effectively ramp up the power of your mind. And that's what I find really exciting about it.
Yeah, absolutely. I've heard David Allen talk too about this creativity overload. You know, the people who are trying to do creative things are the ones who, and that could be, you know, entrepreneurship, that could be podcasting. We're both podcasters. But the people who are, you know, trying to engage in these creative pursuits, they struggle the most with this noise and this backlog because they're always trying to, you know, generate new ideas, new ways of doing things, new things to do. So an accountant, nothing against accountants, but they might not suffer from that kind of backlog and noise of all these new ideas coming in and really not having any way or anywhere to put them or any method for dealing with them.
And yeah, exactly.
I think that, you know, back to these being skills that we already have, but if we don't identify them, they just kind of seem like impulses. You know, people have asked me so many times, why did you start School Sucks Podcast? And there's lots of reasons that I could give. I like the creative process. I had a lot to say on the subject. What I eventually realized is that it was very much a therapeutic exercise because it was allowing for the externalization of all of these things that had just been swimming in my head. Oh, I shouldn't even say swimming in my head. My head was swimming in all of these
right.
things. You know what I mean?
Right.
So
yeah.
To be able to start organizing them and externalizing them in a way that was not only useful to me, but ultimately useful to other people was tremendously therapeutic. And I don't know if you had the same experience with the voluntary life, because obviously you have a tremendous amount of wisdom on how to, you know, live a freer life from your own experience. So would you say that provided you the same benefits?
Oh, totally. And funnily enough, actually, what I found with the voluntary life is this process of getting things out of my head has actually been really great for what I'm doing now, which is writing a book. So I started the voluntary life and I was talking about different ways of finding freedom. And I began to focus more on entrepreneurship because that's my experience. And also because I was getting really great feedback from people about the entrepreneurship podcasts. And so I started talking more about different aspects of entrepreneurship and how entrepreneurship is a way to get more freedom in your life. And gradually, I started building up this sort of backlog of podcasts that I'd done about entrepreneurship and covering different aspects of it. And now, you know, I've really been able to get all of this stuff out of my head and into podcasts and be much more conscious about what I think about how entrepreneurship can be a way to live more freely. And now I'm able to use that content in putting together a book. So that's what I'm doing at the moment is I'm writing a book. But the process of doing the podcast and getting it all out of my head is what sort of enabled me to work out what I was trying to say mm-hmm. and to actually get useful feedback on it in the process. So, yeah, I definitely find it to be really, really helpful in that respect.
So now let's travel back those 7 or 8 years to your discovery.
Yes.
How you instructed yourself on the material and how you installed it into your routines and implemented it in your life.
Yeah. And this is, I think, a really interesting question, because one of the difficulties with getting things done is that there's lots of different aspects to it. And that can be hard because it involves a lot of habits as well.
Mm-hmm.
And habits are normally the way that you adopt habits effectively is to do them one at a time. And, you know, sort of implement a new habit quite consciously, and then off you go. You've started, I don't know, doing exercise in the morning, or you've done whatever it is that you were sort of trying to implement in your life. The problem with getting things done is that there's all these different aspects of GTD. There's all these different habits, and they form a whole approach, but it's quite hard to adopt them all at once because there's kind of a lot to take in. And so for me, I really focused initially on the aspects of GTD that are about getting control. So one of the things that GTD does is helps you to get control over the information flow around you and over the ideas that you've got. Another aspect that it helps you to get is perspective. And that is a forward-looking a sense of where you're going, of your goals, your vision, your purpose, and so forth. And I really started with the control side, because when you're sort of feeling overwhelmed with loads of emails from clients and you've got projects that you're trying to run, it's that control side that, to me, that was the first thing that I needed to sort of get sorted out. So I very much started from the perspective of really implementing and understanding this whole idea of having projects and actions and having your next action. And so all of the different things that I was doing, I already was using a tool for my tasks, and I had time tracking software installed in my business already. So it wasn't that new to me, the idea of identifying individual tasks, but the idea of really being clear about what the objectives of each project are, and then knowing for each one what the next action is, not just in work, but in all aspects of my life, that was really helpful. Because I tended to be quite focused on what the next actions were in my work projects. But then, you know, as you say, you've got to go and pick up laundry or get shopping, or you've got to do something else. And everything is a potential drain on your mind if you haven't kind of consciously worked out what all of your different commitments in life are. So that's where I started, was very much at the sort of control end. And that in GTE terms is the whole thing about workflow. So it's about identifying new stuff as it comes into your life and working out what it is and making it either a project or an action, and making it reference material if you need that, and so forth. And this is the really kind of nuts and bolts, getting your hands dirty end of GTD, which is really about getting a handle on all of the information. The other side of GTD, which is the perspective side, is something that it took me much longer to really sort of understand and get value out of. And it's only in the last couple of years that I've really started to understand some of the ideas around the sort of what David Allen calls the different horizons of focus,
mm-hmm.
Which is beyond managing your kind of day to day. It's understanding how all your different projects fit into different areas of responsibility in your life, and how you have goals. You can have goals and visions for those areas of responsibility, and ultimately link that towards your fundamental purpose. And that is really liberating as well. But it took me a long time to get to that, because I think it's sort of the everyday flow of information that you kind of need to get out of the way first, at least I did, in order to see some of those, I guess, more forward-looking aspects of GTD.
Mm, right. Well, another helpful way to think about it is David Allen describes the interface with this in terms of the five I's. So the first one is the information. What is it? Well, it's a book. It's written by this guy. Here's what it claims to do. The second is the instruction. Okay, how do I do it? The third is the installation. How do I start to incorporate it in my life? What tools do I need, etc.? The implementation, you know, as I'm using it and becoming comfortable with it. And ultimately, the fifth I is integration. And I think what that comes down to, and I just say this because, I mean, I just started doing this a little over a month ago. I immediately wanted to share it with people because I wanted them to understand the dividends that were paid almost immediately in the first aspect that you discussed, as far as dealing with the stuff and making sense of all of the noise and the amount of relief that brought. I mean, I don't feel like the dividends in productivity as of yet have been tremendous for me, barely even noticeable. I feel like I'm working at about the same pace that I was working before. But the way that I feel, having, you know, taken in the information, the instruction, installing it through a variety of tools and implementing it, I can't say it's integrated yet, and I can't say that I have had the time to devote to the horizons aspect of it yet, as far as the long term. But, you know, I was feeling just very stressed, and it was manifesting in these sort of psychosomatic health things. And I stepped back and realized, well, I don't even have that much to do compared to some people.
Right.
But it was just, I didn't have the skills to do what I'm doing. Nothing I had done in the past prepared me for the multifaceted experience of what I'm trying to do with the website and basically being, you know, a one or two man operation. Not that it's anything that's terribly overwhelming. It's just, it's easy to get overwhelmed if you go into something without the skills to do it. The reason why I decided to do the series, I wanted people to feel like it was accessible, you know, and the change happens fast. I mean, we're always talking about, here's a thing that you should do. Watch this, read this, it will change your life. And we have these questions like, okay, well, what's the time frame for implementation? What's the energy required? What's the knowledge deficits I might have? So we are left with all these open loops as people who are concerned with self-improvement, where I'm accepting all these inputs without being ready for them. You know, people say, oh, read this will really help you. Do this. Watch this. Oh, this will really help the show. And I wind up just kind of, you know, feeling like I need a fly swatter for the things that people are trying to give to me to help me, because I don't have a system that allows for the integration, the making of meaning, and turning them into productive use.
Mm, absolutely. I think it's also, it's worth saying that you may find that as you progress in using GTD, that some of the habits slip for a while and you have to kind of reinstall them. And I found that a bit in the beginning. Things like doing a regular weekly review and making sure that you are sort of clearing your inboxes and that kind of stuff. It took me a while for that to become sort of second nature. And it is now, but it will do. And there's a podcast called the Getting Things Done Virtual Study Group, which especially the early podcasts, now they've kind of pretty much covered most of the major topics, so they're onto a bit more obscure things. But the early podcasts in that series are really helpful because they have a lot of people talking about their experience of implementing GTD and the kind of problems that they encounter and how they've found ways around them and little tips and tricks and stuff. And I find that very inspiring. It's even though I've been doing GTD for a long time, I've got a lot of really useful ideas out of that podcast. So, you know, it's one of those things that it can be, for some people, it's not a question of they adopt it and then everything runs smoothly. It actually takes time and you fall off the wagon a bit with some habits and then you kind of re-implement it again. But there's no need to be discouraged, because that's something that everyone experiences. And you can also kind of get encouragement from hearing other people's experience of doing that on things like that podcast.
Yeah, I think one of the more helpful practices with building new habits is finding the things that you can trust. You know, and it's easy, like you say, oh, here's some new app for your phone that you can use to accomplish this goal. But then it doesn't update on time, or it breaks, or it's, you know, it stops working, or it doesn't save something. And you say, well, you know, I can't trust that. And it becomes hard to integrate it. A relatively easy thing to trust is a calendar. And people, I know from my own experience, have tried to substitute that for all of these other tools that are probably necessary and useful as this master organizational tool. A calendar can't do that. It can't be that. That's not what it's for. And you even thinking like, well, you know, this is a representation of time. Time doesn't lie. Tomorrow will definitely be Wednesday. But what you put into that calendar if you start breaking those commitments to yourself and other people, just as, you know, the stuff that happens in life often leads to that happening, then it becomes, you say, well, I can't trust myself with this tool. So the implementation of the GTD system, finding tools and strategies that you can trust is extremely important in the formation of new and lasting habits.
Yeah, I think that's true. Funnily enough for me, the first implementation that I did of GTD was on paper. And I actually used 3x5-inch index cards. There are various people who do little printouts and suggest sort of like templates for action lists and project summaries and stuff like that. And I did that while I was sort of looking at the various apps that were available at the time, and they weren't very good at the time. They're much, much better now. The apps, the GTD apps that are out there now, some of them are great. I found it quite helpful doing it on paper because you talk about a system that you can trust. It was very transparent. So I could see exactly what I was doing, and it was all done by me. And so I knew what my system was, and I could see each project with its little list of actions and then contexts and so forth. And that, I think, was quite helpful because sometimes if you start, for example, one of the more sophisticated GTD apps where you have really great options to remind you that you need to buy something when you pass if you pass a pharmacy, then it's going to give you a reminder that you've got a task for a pharmacy, you know, and all that kind of stuff. But that's so far down the road that it may not be so helpful necessarily learning the system through an app for some people. Some people, if they're really comfortable with that way of learning, then it can work. But yeah, I personally found that I got to really trust the paper system that I was using, and then I wanted it to be more efficient. And so I moved into various GTD apps, and that's what I use now. I use an app called Things, which runs on the Mac, it works really well for me.
Yeah, I have found even I think more than the GTD system and methods, I have found Evernote to be that program for me. And of course, I encourage people who are using, you know, different platforms and you know, have identified different needs to experiment and find what works for them. But Evernote has been absolutely amazing for me. And it was very easy to customize. It was very easy to integrate. And it was, very easy to transfer from platform to platform. So I have a computer that's running Windows 7. Evernote is great. I have an iPod Touch that has Evernote on there, and I have an Android-based phone that has Evernote on there. And it's this what you called in your podcast about 8 tools to free your mind, the ubiquitous capture tool, because it goes anywhere. It syncs with every device that I'm using it on. And it's really been the missing piece, because I had started to, I would say, mess around with GTD a little bit. I think it was about a year ago I had obtained the audiobook, and I was playing it on the iPod, and it was defective. Like it wouldn't go chapter by chapter. And this goes back to my thing, oh, well, you know, you can't trust anything. So scrap that. And I didn't finish it, but I had listened to like the first 45 minutes to an hour and got the gist of, you know, what he was going to lay out in the whole book, and you know, started to think about the system. But what was missing was the software or the application necessary to do a lot of the things that he was talking about, because I wasn't leading a paper-based lifestyle anymore. And, you know, didn't want to do things on paper because it was a system that I had found in the past to, again, be untrustworthy. When right. I discovered Evernote, it answered every question that I had about how to make this work. Evernote provided an answer for me, you know, based on my needs and my pursuits.
Yeah, I think Evernote's awesome. I really, really, I love it as well. I use it all the time. And I think it's, so I guess you're using Evernote for various different aspects of GTD for both reference material and task management and capture. I use Evernote as a reference material store. I put everything in there that I want to keep. And I find that it's just more efficient for me to have a dedicated task manager app for my projects and tasks. But there are loads of people who use Evernote for everything, for every aspect of GTD, and who really enjoy doing it that way. So, yeah, I think it's a really, really helpful tool.
Well, for me, you know, the question is what's the simplest way? And again, that kind of speaks to the benefits of GTD. How can I streamline you know, everything that's going on? So in your podcast, Voluntary Life, number 120, the 8 tools to free your mind, you know, you talk about these 8 different things that you're using. And I realized that Evernote could do 6 of them for me.
Right.
I thought we could go through them and we can, you know, I can tell you what the 6 are.
I
think I would also like to, you know, explicate for people the 8 tools that you've recognized for getting a freer mind, which is really, you know, the goal here. I'll name them and we can talk about what they are and the habits that go with them. The first one was what you call the concentration timer.
Yeah, this is something that actually it's not directly from getting things done. It's from another productivity technique called the Pomodoro technique.
Mm-hmm.
What I've found myself is that in terms of getting things done, I can get beautifully organized in GTD and know all my tasks and actions. And then I can sit in front of my computer and then, oh, it's an interesting email has come in. And then there's something on Facebook that I'm going to have a look at. And then I think about something else. And like I can very easily end up being distracted. And so the idea of the Pomodoro technique is to concentrate on the doing aspect of GTD, and to do that in a sort of very clear way. And it's really simple. It's just the idea is that you make yourself conscious about when you're going to concentrate on specific tasks, and you try and break up your tasks into 25-minute chunks, and then you have a 5-minute break. And so you give your brain like a really clear sort of boundaries, like, okay, now I'm going to focus and I'll do it for 25 minutes and then I'll take a break, so that you know you're going to get a break and be able to kind of relax and take a rest. But you can also sort of work in a really concentrated way. And I find it really helpful as a way of, if I have sort of a lot of work to do, I just plan out my day and then get through as many, they're called Pomodoros, which it comes from the Italian name for tomato, because the original idea was the guy who invented it was just using a little kitchen timer in the shape of a tomato.
Right, right.
And he would just wind it up for 25 minutes. And then once it got down to zero, it pings and that's your break. And
yeah.
So I find that helpful as a way of really focusing. And this is very much in line with the whole idea of GTD, that multitasking just doesn't work. Multitasking is a really inefficient way of trying to get anything done. It's far more effective to focus on tasks one at a time. And it really links in well with GTD, because if you have what's called context in GTD, like, so for example, on very many different projects, you may have one context which is phone calls, or you may have another one which is emails to respond to, or another context. They can be more abstract as well. They can be like doing a mind map or whatever. What you can do is you can choose for 25 minutes to just bash through as many email responses, you know, just focus on, okay, now I'm doing emails for 25 minutes. And, you know, that I think is, that can work really well. You can chunk your work quite effectively into 25-minute chunks. So yeah, that's that one.
Yeah, and there's really very few things in life that can't wait 25 minutes. I mean, there's exceptions, like maybe a fire breaks out, or there's a, you know, a loose tiger or something where you have to deal with it immediately, sure. But in addition to getting rid of that multitasking habit, which is instead of doing one thing really well, three or four things in kind of a mediocre way, we're also establishing presence. And I said at the very beginning of this series that I feel like a lot of people are owed an apology because I was doing something with them, whether it was an interview or a show or even something like plenty of examples of things from my personal life where that person had 65% of my attention. Right. Because of what was swimming in my head or these open loops that were distracting me at the time. And if the concentration timer does anything, it practices that present moment awareness and appropriate engagement with one task. And that's focus, that's presence. And that is so important in our work and our relationships. And I think that's even if you need to set it for 15 minutes or 20 minutes, I think 25 is obviously a great suggestion. And certainly the person who came up with the method did the research. 25 minutes of work, 5 minute break. After you do that four times, take a larger break. That's certainly adaptable for different situations.
But yeah,
there aren't many
things.
Some
people adjusted the length of time to suit themselves, and that's great if it works better for people at 20 minutes or 30 minutes or whatever. And of course, if you have to interrupt, then if you really can't focus for 25 minutes, then you just cancel that Pomodoro. And you don't count it. And that's information too. You know, that's useful. It's like, okay, well, why did I really have to interrupt this? Was it really necessary for me to go and respond to some email? Or, you know, is that actually more the kind of panicky part of my brain that I'm letting sort of get in the way of my true purpose for today and what I really want to, what's really going to be more fulfilling for me? And so it's an opportunity for self-knowledge too, because you know, you can cancel a Pomodoro, but if you do, then there's a, you know, it's worthwhile thinking about, okay, well, you know, how come I wasn't able to concentrate for 25 minutes?
Right, absolutely. That actually kind of leads us nicely right into the second tool, which is a journal. What do you think the significance or the importance of keeping a journal is?
Oh, this was really big for me, was getting into journaling. And I did not like it at first. I think there's, you know, a part of me that thought like, oh, you know, I should be getting on with work. This is kind of, this is getting in the way of other more productive things that I want to do. But actually, I find it incredibly helpful. Journaling is just a way of getting things out of your head. And that's fundamental to the whole idea behind GTD. It's all about getting things out of your head. One of the fundamental little techniques that David Allen talks about is what he calls a core dump, which is it's an analogy from, you know, when a computer crashes and writes everything that was in RAM to the hard disk to say, okay, this is all the stuff that was going on in my head, so to speak. And the idea is for you to do that, just get down everything that's in your head, because getting it out on paper enables you to go through it and work out, okay, well, what is this that's going on? What am I thinking about? What is that, a project? What do I need to do about that? What's the next action? And for me, journaling's just a way of doing that kind of core dump every morning, just getting everything out of my head. And I find it really helpful, especially if I'm so, for example, at the moment, I'm writing this book about entrepreneurship. And there are a couple of chapters that I'm really having difficulty with and not sure quite what the problem is. And I journal about it in the morning, and it kind of helps me just get things out of my head and realize what is what's going on. Or if you have a conflict with someone, you can write about it, and that sort of gets all of the stuff that's tangled up in your mind out of your head, and you can be a lot more conscious about what you're role in that conflict has been, what your responsibilities are, what you're bringing to it. And that enables you to actually be much more productive in your relationships and so forth. So I just find journaling to be a really helpful tool.
Yeah, and this is one place where I would make an exception to my paperless rule. I find that it is really helpful to actually go through the process of handwriting this stuff. When you're using like the GTD principle of reference and going back through, you know, references, it's usually you're not skimming, you're scanning when you do that. You're looking for something specific when you're going through your reference folder. So it's nice to have a journal that's physical, tangible, that you can flip through. I recently was going through some boxes. I found a journal that I was keeping back in like 2005. And it was interesting just to read through a few pages of it and see, like, this is where I was. These are the things that changed. Mm-hmm. All just as a frame of reference for what I had learned about certain aspects of my life. And again, it's the same principle, getting things out of your head and being able to look at your ideas at a later point objectively. Because our emotional state will change. Our ideas or our thoughts will be mixed with emotions in a moment, right? And that's hard. Yeah. Makes it hard to do, you know, a proper evaluation of them. So we get the ideas out, whatever those emotions are that we might be caught up in the moment. Well, we go back and we look at that a week later, our emotional state is different, and we are able to, you know, have maybe a clearer assessment of what those ideas are and what they mean.
Absolutely. I find it super fascinating to go back and look at journal entries from the past as well. I actually do mine digitally. I don't. And the reason for that is because I can just type so much faster than I can write. Mm. So the efficiency loss of writing is so huge that I just don't have the patience for it. So I use a digital journal app. And but yeah, going back, I've been journaling intensively or sort of more consistently since 2007. And it's super fascinating going back. And as you say, when you have that emotional distance from it, you can actually really learn a lot about what was going on for you and what was sort of maybe triggering you with strong emotions at the time, where now that you've sort of got some distance from it, you can look back on it more objectively. But as you say, also, even over the last week, if you go back and read the entries over the last week, you can see the themes that have been on your mind, things that you've been thinking about. And it's one of those things that also I find really supports your intuition, because let's say you've got something on your mind and you're writing about it, journaling about it. It's all down there in words. You've written it in text. Then you go and sleep on it a couple of days and you come to solutions because you're just more conscious about it. So your intuition knows what you're thinking about, so to speak. And I find that's actually a real, really helpful way of sort of supporting my intuition in terms of finding solutions to the things that I'm thinking about.
Excellent. Excellent. So the next, those two, I think, are kind of separate from the whole GTD method, even though they both closely relate. The next six are really, really consistent with David Allen's program. The third one we mentioned briefly already, the ubiquitous capture tool.
Yes. So this is really just something to capture your thoughts wherever you are. And the idea here is that your brain just pops out interesting ideas or useful ideas, or you see things or people tell you things and you think, oh, I must remember that. That's useful. And that's just deadly because, first of all, you forget. And secondly, it's really frustrating because you think, what was that thing? I know there was something I was supposed to remember.
All you know is that you forgot.
Exactly, exactly. So the ubiquitous capture tool is just something to capture information wherever you are. And Brett, you mentioned Evernote. So Evernote is great for things like if you see something online, you can use a clipper to clip a web page into Evernote. You can forward emails in. It's a great place for capturing stuff. Personally, what I find is that the capture tool that I find most useful is for my own thoughts, walking around or whatever I'm doing. The problem I have with Evernote is that even if you have it on your phone, it takes a long time to load. And if you're, you know, if you think of something, and for me, even if it's just like 5-10 seconds or whatever, it's loading up and then it's getting ready and then you're new and it's a bit annoying. So I use an app called Drafts, which on an iPhone, it just loads immediately and it has a fresh blank page for you to then capture a thought on. And it does that each time you click on it. It automatically load up a new blank page. Other people use pen and paper. and just carry that around. So it, whatever works for you is good. I also find sometimes that I use the voice memo on my phone, because especially if I'm if I don't want to try and type with my thumb or whatever, I can just click the voice memo and say something into it, and then I can then I've got that captured as well.
Yeah, another thing too that I just want to mention here about capturing ideas as they come, this relates to journaling as well. One way that I've tried to build this habit as of late is I was getting into bed every night with like my phone and my iPod, and I'm listening to a podcast and I'm playing Words with Friends, and you know, I'm constantly being hyper-stimulated by the internet and Facebook. And what I realized is that my own internal voice was very quiet because it was being drowned out by all this external stimuli that I was putting into my head at all times.
Right.
So to get into the routine of being more aware, not just of internal dialogue and thoughts, it's better to turn the volume of all of those other inputs down, I find. I was recently talking with a friend about an experiment of not going online for a week. I don't know if I can do it or not. I don't know what kind of a feat that is, considering there's, you know, probably 2 or 3 billion people who do it every day, or who you know, who do it every week rather. For me, based on how I live and how I interface with the rest of the world, it would be quite a feat. I don't even know if it's feasible, but I would like to see, and if other people can do it and report back to me, I'd love to know what they find out. What changes as far as what thought process alterations there are? And I've talked about this a lot on the show. How is the internet affecting how we think, how we grow, how we interact with other people? Are we evolved enough to handle it? So drowning out some of that other noise helps us form this habit of being aware of the need to capture our own thoughts.
Oh, yeah, absolutely. I'm currently implementing a habit in my life, which is that I every morning, there are three things that I want to do before I look at any social media like Facebook or anything like that, and before I check email. So that is to journal, to run through all of my task context lists, which I run through each morning, and to do exercise. So normally that's yoga or rollerblading or something like that. Mm-hmm. And even doing those three things before I check email, you know, it's actually something that I've had to be conscious about and use willpower for, because it does become a huge distraction. New information, more new information, more new information. David Allen or somebody, I think, talked about putting yourself on an information diet. You know, right. You look at all the sources of noise coming into your life and try and look at what your diet is at the moment for information and how you can be more conscious about it. And I have been in some ways. I mean, we don't have a TV because I know that when I am in a place with a TV, if I'm tired, I'll just sit on the sofa and watch it, whatever it is, even if it turns out to be sharks and Nazis, as the I think Ricky Gervais was saying that the was it History Channel and Nature Channel is just sharks and Nazis, you know. So I'll just end up watching stuff on TV if I have one. So that's one of the ways that I kind of limit the information coming in. And we'll probably talk about that when we talk about some of the other tools as well, how you can limit your information coming in.
Sure, sure. That again leads right into the next one. Number four, you called the stuff funnel.
Yeah. So in GTD, David Allen makes a sort of talks a lot about your inbox and about when things come into your life, you know, you get a letter or you can bring something home in your wallet, a receipt or something, you put it all in this inbox and then you go through it. The problem for people now is that a lot of the information is not physical coming into your life in the form of a piece of paper, it's digital. So that automatically means that maybe you have a physical inbox, but you also have a digital inbox. And if like me, you may sometimes also note things down on your phone or in your voice memo or something, then you also have those inboxes. And you also have a download folder where you've downloaded things onto your computer. So there are a number of little places in your life where things can start to accumulate, that new stuff that you need to process. And so rather than think about it just in terms of an inbox, I think about it in terms of a funnel of different places, like your downloads folder, your physical inbox, your email inbox, and so forth. And the idea is all of that information ultimately has to get funneled through to one place, which for me, it's my task management system. For you, it might be Evernote. And it needs to get turned either into actions or projects or reference material or something. It needs to get processed. And to process it, you have to make sure that you've collected and funneled all that information through to one point where you can process.
Yeah, and I think that there's an important distinction to make here that was, you know, up until recently, I wasn't really making in my life, the distinction between collecting, processing, and organizing. And obviously, processing and organizing are much more related to each other than either of them are to collecting. And, you know, in educational psychology, in my own experience in, you know, working with learning disabilities and IEPs, individualized education plans, this term appeared years ago called executive functioning, and how people were, you know, processing and dealing with and organizing and intaking all of the information in an academic environment. And people were having these executive functioning issues, it was called. And I realized that was actually kind of a handy term and a useful way of thinking about this process. And maybe you picture a board meeting where you or me or whoever is the executive. And we have this one side of us that is, you know, the artist, the graphic designer, the person who has like a looser structure to their life. And you're mediating between an artist and somebody who might be more like the accountant, you know, who's very organized and rigid. And also to not pigeonhole ourselves into one role or the other, like say, oh, well, you know, I'm very right brain, so I have to resign myself to being disorganized, or I'm left brain, so I'll never really be this creative free spirit. We all have both sides of that brain and have the ability to use both sides of the brain. I think we get stuck in what's more comfortable and what's more applicable to our professional lives. But, you know, the artist side of us is what has all these ideas and all of these creative impulses. And, you know, separating the process of capturing that stuff and organizing it, that it can be made useful, it can be processed later, it can be put into action later, but having a very clear, not only place, whether it's digital or physical, or, you know, as David Allen suggests, both, for all of that stuff to go first is very, very important, because I would have ideas and then start saying, okay, well, what could I do with it? And I would be the, you know, the judge, jury, and executioner of ideas as I had right. them, instead of just capturing them and saying, here's an idea, maybe it's dumb, we'll see, right? And yeah. and we'll figure it out later, we'll see what it fits into. Is it part of a project? Is it you know, the jumping off point that can become its own project? I would just say, that's an idea. Oh, well, isn't that nice? Is that useful to me right now? No, how could I implement it? I don't have any time. All right, scrap it. And then it would just get stored as, you know, something potentially useful that I discarded, but there's still that idea-sized hole in my head eating away at my attention and, you know, times 1,000. So just saying, okay, here's an idea. It's been captured. It's put in the stuff funnel. It goes in the inbox for processing later has been very helpful.
Yeah, I think that's so, so important to recognize those different sides and to respect those different sides of our thinking. And I know exactly how you feel, and I know exactly what you mean. I also, it reminds me of the rules when you're doing brainstorming. You know, you have that, the rule about brainstorming. If a group of people are trying to think of ideas for something, the rule is you get all the ideas up on the wall and nobody gets to criticize them, first of all, because if you start saying, well, no, that would never work, then it just completely jars the process of exploration. So the rule is, okay, no criticism, just get all the ideas up. And then you change to a different process, which is, right, now let's process these ideas and which ones can we do and which ones we can't. And it's really important to not mix those two processes in the group. So and that's the same, I think, with inside our own heads. So for me, I actually have to do those different tasks at different times. So as you say, when I'm wandering around and thinking of things, I come up with the ideas, the creative stuff. And then I devote a period of time, like once a week, as part of my review, I do processing where I empty all my inboxes and I work out, okay, what's this? Where does it belong? And so forth. And I have to do that different at a different time. So I do that on a Thursday myself. And I actually do my project review and my Someday Maybe review and the forward-looking stuff. I do that on Friday because I don't want to try and do like the sort of processing and then try and think more creatively about projects, because it's actually, I find it too hard to do them one after another because it's a sort of switching mindsets. So yeah, I think it's really important to find ways that you can actually really let the different mindsets that you have to adopt in order to get things done flourish without kind of interfering with each other.
Yeah. And that, again, this is the way you set up this list, Jake, is really nice because one just goes into the other one perfectly. Number five, now we're moving beyond capture into processing, reviewing, organizing, and doing with a task management tool, number five.
Yeah. And this is really where your projects and your actions live. And that's the sort of core of a task management tool is you've got projects and actions on them. And so you can use anything you want for this. You can start. You can use paper, as I did when I started, or you can customize Evernote or use one of the customizations that other people have done, or you can use a specific app. And that's what I use. And that app really is just a way of organizing each individual action and being able to query by context or by project and so forth. So a task management tool is just a database of your projects and your actions that's designed in a very easy to use interface. And you can either create that as a paper-based system or anything you like.
Yeah. And I use Evernote for this. There was this handy feature that I discovered where you can just, you can make bulleted lists in Windows Word, you can do little checkboxes. So once you have a notebook, I mean, I have one master notebook called Current Projects and sub notebooks for every project that I'm working on. This is where all of the lists can go of next actions, things that need to be done with check marks. And it feels good, feels great to be able to put little check marks next to things. It's very empowering and it's motivating to see the individual tasks within a project that are getting done. But within that notebook, you can also put the tools or the reference material that you need. If there's a website, if there's an email correspondence that relates to what you're doing, it can just be dragged or copied and pasted. Worst case scenario, you copy and paste something into a note, and everything, every aspect of a project, save for the physical presence of other people, aside from that, everything is there. So it has worked for me in that respect. And again, this is what I'm just saying. It's worked for me because I'm into simplicity. If people can manage multiple tools, I recommend that they do that. But Evernote has worked as a task management tool so far.
Cool.
So another thing that I'm using it for is number six on your list, reference material storage.
Yeah, I'm using Evernote too. I used to have a paper-based reference tool, and I've gone paperless now, and I use Evernote for everything. And that's great because it means that there's also no longer some stuff that's digital and some stuff that's paper. It's just everything is in Evernote and it's all scanned. All previous paper has been scanned in there as well. And yeah, the idea of a reference material store is just, this is just stuff that you're not currently looking at, but you may need to look at it at some point in the future. So you need to be able to access it, which means that if it's a paper-based system, you have to have some kind of filing system. And if it's digital, then you have to have some kind of filing system. The great thing about Evernote is that it's so easy to find stuff because it does OCR on all pictures and text that you scan. And you can have names for notes, but you can also have tags and you can also put them in notebooks. So you can have any kind of filing system you like. And even if you don't have a very well-organized filing system, you can still find stuff with search. But organizing it is actually really, really helpful because it organizes your mind in doing so.
Yeah.
So, yeah.
And having a reference store is really, really useful when, first of all, just if you're living in the age of information, in which we all live, if you're listening to this, or if you are a media creator, because people are always sending things to me like, here'd be a good thing for a show. And, within reference, there's several subcategories, you know, from art to the website, you know, just like files that I would need to recall. You know, I keep all financial and marketing information. So everything is easy to find in the way Evernote is set up. But, you know, another thing that David Allen, another term that he uses is incubation, which is not technically a part of reference, and is sometimes called someday maybe or a tickler file. Things that are likely to happen, things that are someday going to be translated into actions, but just not in a place where they are actionable yet for one reason or another. That I think that's worth pointing out. It's not exactly reference, but it is also just another place where those things can be stored and externalized.
Yeah, absolutely.
The seventh one, we actually did a show about this recently, a mind mapping tool.
Yeah. This is something that David Allen talks about as a sort of helpful tool as part of G2D, as a way of getting things out of your head and thinking about things. And in particular, he talks about it when he talks about project planning using what he calls the natural planning model. And that's sort of a bigger discussion in itself. But I only really got into mind maps about 3 years ago, and I've been using them more and more intensively since then, and I just find them incredibly helpful. They're a really, really great way of thinking about something and making connections which you don't necessarily initially get just by writing text. Somehow the process of a mind map, which is, you know, it's basically just like a diagram with circles and words and links. And you can actually do any kind of mind map you like. You can be as creative as you want. But by linking words together and linking concepts together and forming kind of hierarchies of different things that are linked, you establish connections around a subject. So I find if I'm planning a podcast, or if I'm planning a project, or thinking about all of my responsibilities in a specific area, whatever it is, I just write the subject in the middle, and then I start drawing lines off it and linking things to it. And then I think, well, what links to that? And it's just a great way of sort of getting things out of your head.
Yeah, the tool that we covered in my show recently is called the Brain. Or it used to be called the Personal Brain software, and it's a free program. There is a paid version of it. And I would describe myself at this point as still trying to build trust with or build trust in this system. I'm surrounded by people who trust it very much. All the people that I've been working with from Tragedy and Hope use the Brain. They've had tremendous success. They incorporate it into their media presentations. And I've definitely identified it as somebody who was, you know, mind mapping out podcasts years ago when I was less comfortable with the routine of creating a presentation. Having everything externalized and in front of the eyes was very important with those early shows before it became a more natural and automatic process. And still obviously very useful with more complex subjects. I used to have a room a couple of years ago where almost all of the walls were dry erase boards. So it was very easy to just get up and have all of this free space to do out one of these diagrams for a show topic. Because sometimes they're complex. Sometimes you don't realize that you're dealing with a bunch of superfluous information that might be interesting. Your attention might be being pulled that way. But, you know, part of the natural planning model is also, you know, clarifying the purpose, the principles, and understanding what the outcome needs to be. Mm. And that allows you, if you're doing that stuff on the front end, definitely clarifying what a successful outcome is and the purpose of the project, you don't have to be so specific, because you're less likely to be sucked into the tractor beam of some compelling creative impulse that might not serve the larger purpose or contribute to the ultimate outcome. But mind mapping helps you see all of that. And once you start to understand a hierarchy, and once you start to understand connections, you can see what maybe is, you know, with reference to a podcast or a video, can be left on the cutting room floor.
Yeah, absolutely. I like that image, the Death Star tractor beam of creative impulse.
Exactly. And the last one, which was actually really helpful for me and relates to number four and number six, is the media consumption queue.
Yeah. So a media queue, David Allen talks about this a little bit. His book now is a little bit outdated because it's more paper-based, but he talks about having a list of things that you're going to read later. So, you know, you sort of collect the books that you're going to read later and so forth. Thing is, these days, you have things that you're going to read later, but you also have things that you might listen to later, like a podcast or an audiobook. And most of all, a lot of things that you might watch later or read later online. And so the idea here is that if you're looking at Facebook or something, and somebody posts an interesting article, what are you going to do? Because it's like, oh, I'd quite like to read that. That does look quite interesting. But then again, if I read that, then I'm going to be here for the next 10 minutes and I actually need to get on with something. I just wanted to have a quick check of Facebook. So what am I going to do? Am I going to read it and lose the time or just forget about it? And the idea is that you put those things in a queue. And you do that using an application. I guess you could do it manually, but it's so easy to do it with an application. So for reading later, there are applications like Instapaper. And for watching later, you can use one of the Watch Later features either on YouTube or there's various apps. I use one called Watch Later app, which links both YouTube and Vimeo and various other video sources. So that way, you build up a queue of stuff that you're going to watch or stuff that you're going to read. And it's also a really good way of going on an information diet, because when you first see something, it seems like, wow, that's really interesting. I want to read this article or watch this video. But actually, if you put it in your queue and come back to it when you have time, you may also find that there were five other things that you want to read. And you can be a bit more discerning now that the initial, like, oh, that looks interesting, you know, shiny new object, now that that sort of curiosity is gone, you can be a bit more discerning. Like, is it really worth your time to watch this obscure documentary that someone's posted that looked interesting at first? But, you know, is it really something you want to watch or this article that's actually quite long? So I find even putting things in a queue, I find really helpful because I actually just delete some of them later. If I get to the end of the week and I'm going through my lists and clearing my lists, you know, I find, okay, I don't really need to watch that. I don't really need to read that. But I always know if I do capture those things that if they are interesting, the next time I'm sitting on a train or something, I can open Instapaper and I've got all these articles that I can read. And so it's a very effective way of using your time to actually using those in-between times when you can't necessarily do effective work to catch up on things that you wanted to read or stuff you wanted to watch, rather than being distracted when you're actually trying to get on with your day and a new bit of media comes into your life.
Yeah. So this was very helpful for me when I listened to your podcast this morning. And I've been using something called the Evernote Web Clipper, which we mentioned. And what it does is, you know, it's just a Firefox installation as a plugin. You click on it when you want to clip something. It can clip a section or it can clip the entire page. And if it's a YouTube video or an article, it just goes now into a notebook called Media Consumption Queue, and I can go through that when I have time. You know, so, I mean, in the past, cool. It was like people were always sending me things, and I feel like my tone of voice just made it sound like I was annoyed by this. And I think in the past, I was. I really, like, you know, do you have to send me every time some police state thing happens in government school? Do I have to know about it, Facebook? It's okay. Like, but it wasn't something that somebody else was doing wrong. It was, in fact, something that somebody else was doing to be thoughtful and to maybe enhance, from their point of view, enhance the production of my show. what I realized, and this also, there's some integration in the other aspects of planning and organizing, and this takes us back to purpose. I used to get sucked into something that looked compelling, like here's this terrible police state thing that happened to this homeschooling family or happened to this kid in government school. And, you know, as much as I understand that that deserves to have time and attention devoted to it, and those people deserve a voice that they might not know how to get on their own, I also now can balance that with the question of, does this serve the purpose of my show? And is it something that I can do something useful with in the time that I have? Because what the worst thing that happens is I say, yes, this deserves attention. So I devote 20 minutes of my time to investigating this, but then realizing that I don't have another 2 hours of time to produce a show about it. So the net result is negative 20 minutes of my time, and I've done nothing to help them. So yeah,
I think that's a great point. Yeah, I was just gonna quickly say on that that I think it's also, you know, the as well as the initial curiosity, there's the fact that you can get your sort of fight or flight response triggered by stuff that people post on Facebook or whatever that makes you think, oh, this is important, this is interesting. But if you get a chance to reflect on it, then you can have that more sort of measured reflection that you just talked about with this article. Like, okay, yeah, this is bad, but is it actually going to help anyone for me to spend my time on this? Because I've actually got a show to produce. So I think that makes a huge amount of sense.
And it also, as far as big picture thinking is concerned, I understand that even though I, you know, have a commitment to these issues, there's no way that I can address every awful thing that happens in government schools or within education or homeschooling legislation or, you know, the testing of new police state tactics on kids. So it's almost like, well, is it even fair to devote, you know, 2 hours to something and ignore something else when the larger mission of the show is to raise awareness about these problems? And if I stay on that purpose, I'm doing the best I can for all of these individual situations, but there's things that are outside the realm of my responsibilities and outside the realm of my capabilities. And seeing the big picture allows me to recognize that better and not get sucked into some of these things like I did before. You know, the other benefit of the media consumption queue, just as far as like peace of mind and organization, I have this folder in Firefox called SSP Show Prep. I opened it the other day, you know, as I was trying to clean out all of these dumps that I had made for stuff, I was horrified. There was like 500 things in there, you know, and before it was just like somebody like, Brett, here's a 4-hour video series that you'll find really helpful and, you know, really benefit your audience. And I'm like, oh, well, okay, I'll keep you posted, you know, but now somebody sends me something. I say, okay, here's an input that I need to identify and make sense of and decide where it goes. So maybe first it just goes to in. When I'm cleaning out in, I get back to it for processing. Does this serve the purpose? Does this accomplish some kind of goal? No, then it's trash. And sorry, there's nothing I can do with it right now, or I'm not the guy, or it just goes away. If it can be integrated, what purpose does it serve? Is it part of a project? And then it can go in the process of being moved forward. So being able to switch focus from thing to thing, because, you know, obviously being present and being devoted to a task is good. But David Allen also talks about the mind like water of being able to deal with something unexpected, integrate it and get back to calm and keep moving forward. And I think that's a part of that.
Yeah, absolutely. And if you know, that's the great thing about having a queue for your media is that it means that you can capture those things. You know, you don't have to get frustrated and annoyed when people send you interesting links, as you were talking about, because it's like, okay, great, someone sent me an interesting link. I'll capture it. I don't have to deal with it now. I can carry on working on whatever else I wanted to work on. And the fact that it's a queue, you know, what is implied by that is also a queue needs processing. So rather than it becoming this dump of links and stuff, and I know exactly what you mean about, I cleared out all of my bookmarks as well. I don't use bookmarks really anymore, except for quick access to a few websites that like Google, whatever I'm going to use all the time. But actually stuff that I might watch, whatever, it goes in a queue because a queue gets processed and I'm either going to look at it or I'm not. I'm going to decide not to, but I make a decision about it. And then there's no longer this backlog of stuff that needs processing.
Yeah. And just one more note specific to what we do as, you know, voluntarist or libertarian media producers. When somebody sends something to us because they think it's interesting, a lot of the time it's interesting because in a certain way it's horrifying, right? And it's disturbing and it's upsetting. So we talked about Mind Like Water. I introduced in a recent show the concept from my own experience of mind like crowded amusement park wave pool. Right? So not only do we have all these inputs that we can't process, the inputs are triggering some kind of emotional tumult in us. So if somebody sends me a video about something that's upsetting or it's angering or whatever the emotion is, I consume that. Not only do I have nothing to do with it from that point, now I try to return to what I was doing with wave pool mind, which means that it's distracting from the process that I was trying to commit my time and energy and focus to entirely. So that's also dangerous, you know. This is just such a simple thing to integrate into this system that you suggested, the media consumption cue, that it can eliminate all kinds of problems that I was having before.
Awesome. I'm really glad that it's that you found it helpful. That's great.
So do you have any closing thoughts?
Just to say, I really encourage anyone who's interested in this to experiment and give it a go and use it, because I have found it enormously helpful. And I know lots of people who also adapt GTD. And as you can see from that list, there are a couple of things in there, as you mentioned, that aren't really from GTD, the Pomodoro technique and journaling and stuff. So I've also adapted GTD to my own purposes to some extent. But I think a core part of freedom is, as you said at the beginning, is freeing your mind. You can't really live free if you've got that amusement park wave pool thing going on that you just talked about, Brett. And this is a fantastic framework to help anyone to free their mind of clutter and thoughts that they haven't found a way to get a handle on, and move to a state of mind where you can really focus on what matters to you and do what you want with your life.